We've already had our first two TREMI finals. TREMI, there are three of them. And we've already sent through the Fame Labbers from Australia, Cyprus, Italy, Poland, Qatar, South Africa, Spain, and somewhere or another called the UK. And in the next hour and a half, we'll decide who from Bulgaria, Egypt, Germany, Greece, Hong Kong, Ireland, Malaysia, Portugal, and the USA, that's in alphabetical order, will be joining them. So for starters, who's here? Who's come along to this one and this one only? Marvellous. Is that due to national biases or just availability? Don't all try and answer that at once. And who's been here for the long haul? Brilliant. Let's see. If you manage to survive to the end, I'll get you a bonus round of applause. That's great. And who is not only here for this one only, but has never been to a Fame Lab before? A smaller but important subgroup. Okay. Well, you'll mostly figure it out as you go along. But the key points are everyone gets 3 minutes, no PowerPoint, no charts, no complex electrical stuff, only the props they can bring on themselves to try and get across something about science, something about the wonder, something about the amazement, but something about the how as well as the wow, something to amaze and amuse, to scintillate, to stimulate. And it can be about anything, it can be about their own work or something else. Those are the only real constrictions that take place. Well, there's a no nudity clause we've written in since the last semi-final, but anyway. And otherwise, you'll pick it up as you go along. They have to answer a couple of minutes of judges' questions. The judges will be choosing three equal people to go through to tomorrow night's final. And you, the audience, will also be selecting one yourselves. If you're one happens to coincide with the judges' one, and you don't know who they've chosen when you're choosing, then that's just the way things work out. If you send through somebody different, that's also fine. And if, as happened in the first TREMI final, the voting system doesn't work, we end up sending through two people as well as the judges. So that's going to be fun when it comes to tomorrow. So the key point to remember is what you're about to see is nine more Fame Labbers from nine other countries. And while I'll still be on stage tomorrow for the final, most of them won't be. It doesn't matter how silky their skills, how scintillating their science. Unfortunately, the nature of this is only three of them will be selected by the judges, possibly plus one more from yours. So who are these judges? Let's get them up here. Our chair is a past winner of South Africa's National Science and Technology Forum Awards for Science Communication, current director of their science communication agency, Jive Media Africa, and founding board member of the Yazi Center for Science and Society in Africa. Please welcome Robert Ingalls. Joining him, or technically rejoining him, since she was also our chair for the first TREMI final, we've someone who, unless they've had a career-changing last couple of hours, is still a geneticist, biotechnologist, encourager of collaboration, and now science attaché to the British ambassador in Israel, Ronnie Prower. Welcome back. And last, but also in dimensional terms least, we have someone who tweets as at FunSizeSuze and describes themselves as a nanochemist literally and professionally. Think about it. She's also a teaching fellow in the Department of Materials at Imperial College London and a science presenter, Dr. Suze Kundu. Suze. So, Robert, as a memory jog for our audience, and to check you know the rules of engagement, what are the key criteria that you will be judging these ninesome on?
All right, we're looking at content, clarity, and charisma. Do we need to tell them what that is?
You don't need to, but I'd like you to.
So content is about making sure that there is something of substance from a scientific perspective there. We're not here to listen to a nice talk. We're here to listen to a talk about science, and it's got to be engaging. But it needs to be substantial scientific content. Perhaps we'll walk away with a feeling like we haven't heard that before. That was interesting.
And just for the sake of clarity about content, it can be nice and about science at the same time. Fine, okay, fine.
Thank you. The second is clarity, and it's really about making sure that we're able to follow your progression through your talk. 3 minutes is quite a lot of words, in fact, and if we're not with you all the way, then you'll lose us. So clarity is about making sure that every step of the way we're with you and we understand where you're going.
Right, rather than, oh, that was an interesting bit, I've drifted off. Oh, that was another interesting bit, I've drifted off, which can happen even in the best science presenters
Absolutely.
Sometimes. And
Absolutely.
The third, the elusive charisma.
The X factor, that's little difficult to define characteristic, but it's really about creating engagement with your audience. We need you to connect with your audience first as people, and secondly as scientists. We, as a public, we enjoy connecting with people. People connect to people. And so that needs to come through. And so all of those characteristics of emotion and the stuff we all hold common, feelings, emotions, that's charisma, and you need to bring it through into your talk.
It's very difficult to define charisma, except to say, hey. Now, Suze, everyone here is a winner in their own country. They've got different levels of English skills. They've had different experiences getting through here. Is there any scientifically sound way of fairly judging them?
Well, I do think the three C's are actually a really great way to distill science. That the main sort of components that are going to make a good talk, I don't think it matters, you know, what country you're from, what language you speak. I think it's the way that you communicate. And I know that the three of us are really looking forward to all the imaginative ways that you guys are going to have come up with. So... really excited.
Okay, one question for Ronnie before we start bringing them forward. It's a bit late for words of wisdom, but if you did have a chance to give any guidance to them, what would you say?
Well, I would rewrite in the... No, I'm joking. just tell us what you're doing. Like, we're all here because we're fascinated. So, you know, your passion and your curiosity is infectious. Just tell us about it and enjoy it because, you know, you've made it this far, so... And he's awesome, so be fun.
Thank you. This is the one area of science where it's okay to be infectious. Okay. Judges have a very tricky task trisecting our nine and picking only three to go through. So can we please thank them for giving up their time to do this, because it is a really tough job. As those of you who are at the first two Tremi finals will have seen, it's almost impossible. Some really brilliant people have not gone through, and some really brilliant people have gone through, but some really brilliant people haven't gone through as well. Now, as I say as well, it's also tricky because the Famelab, some of them are doing this in their second language, some their third, so bear that in mind as well. There's a lot of trickiness, and you, the audience, are not exempt from it as well, because you will have this task at the end of selecting one from the nine to go through. If it overlaps with the judges, that's the way it works out. If it's independent, that's the way it is. Right, so history half told, rules half explained, judges half introduced. Let's get wholeheartedly onto Famelab and seeing our winners in action. The order was based on the percentage of agricultural land devoted to growing rhubarb cross-indexed against hat size and who could do the best drawing of a Higgs boson. And that means it's Ireland who go first. Niamh Kavanagh loves lasers and is fascinated by fiber optics, which is handy as she's a photonics PhD student at Tyndall National Institute, University College Cork. Niamh is also a black belt. I'm not told in what, maybe it's origami, and a stilt walker, but right now her laser sights are set on Famelab. It is tough being the opener, so pop open the applause for our corker from Cork, Niamh Kavanagh.
Thank you. You're lying on an operating table, waiting for surgery. Your heart is racing, your hands are sweaty, and your stomach flips if anyone speaks. You take a breath to steady your nerves. Above you, holding the scalpel, is a robot. On the other side of the world, your surgeon sits at a console preparing to operate. For safe operation, when the surgeon moves the controls, the robot must respond in less than a fifth of a second. That's literally less than the blink of an eye. This isn't like a movie on Netflix. It can't pause and say patient loading. We need to send super high definition video, precise movements, and simultaneous voice commands across thousands of kilometers, and we need to do it faster than you can blink. How is this possible? The answer is fiber optics. An optical fiber is a solid strand of really pure glass that's thinner than a hair. They're like pipes for light. Video and voice data can be turned into pulses of light using a laser. This light travels down the fiber by bouncing along the walls, but because it travels through glass, the light can only go at 70% of its full speed. My research in Ireland is looking at new optical fibres that are hollow rather than solid. In hollow fibres, light moves through air rather than glass, and this means that the light can travel at 99.7% of its full speed. This can make a big difference when someone's life is on the line. Today, robots are the tool of choice for many cancer operations, but usually the surgeon controlling the robot is a few meters away, not a few countries away. The marriage of robotics and fast fiber optics could revolutionize long-distance surgery. Patients in need of specialized operations won't have to go to another country. Surgeons won't have to enter dangerous areas such as war zones. Without the need to travel, life-saving surgeries can take place without delay. But the question remains, would you let a surgeon operate on you from the other side of the world? My hope is, in the future, if you're on an operating table and above you a robot holds the scalpel, you'll take a breath and feel safe, knowing that in the blink of an eye, fiber optics are bringing the best surgeon to you.
Neat, that was fascinating. And obviously remote surgery is something that, you know, would revolutionize the way we, health equality across the globe.
Yes, yeah.
So I have a question about remote surgery, and that is, so when a surgeon has a scalpel poised above an organ, one of the things that informs the surgeon is the resistance of that organ. So you sort of move into an area and you're like, oh, wait, hang on, that I shouldn't touch that. Yes. It's a little bit squishy or something like that. So how is the robot going to feed back to the surgeon who's in a different country?
Yes, I actually got to talk to one of the surgeons that uses the robot, which I was so happy about, because they actually have one in the maternity hospital up the road from where I work. And he said that when you're using the robot, when you hit something hard, although the robotic company can't advertise that they have haptic sensation, he said that when you hit something hard, say example, like an artery, like you said, that you feel a difference in movement in the controls, and that because your eyes are looking into that 3D view of the console, that your brain then interprets that as, oh, that's something hard. So he says it does. You can actually feel with the console, like they put their hands into little gloves, and then the gloves are on the joysticks. So you can actually interpret that movement. It's amazing, it really, really is, yeah.
I'm not sure I feel safe quite yet, but getting there.
Niamh, that was a great talk, really engaging. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You said that you're working on the actual fiber optics, these hollow tubes.
Yes.
As a material scientist, sort of slightly curious, slightly selfish, sorry, question, what kind of materials are you using to create this, and what are your kind of ideal material properties? What are your limitations?
The limitations are actually like the fabrication process. So the tube is actually made from silica glass, and how they do it, how they make it is they have what they call a preform, and it's like a big bunch of straws, basically glass straws, with a gap in the middle. And then they heat that up and they heat that up. So the ideal properties, like you were saying, is to minimize the irregularities. So to make it as smooth as possible, to reduce scattering losses in the fiber. So they make it from really, really pure silica glass. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Neve, putting some cutting edge technology and some intellectual fiber in our diet. Neve Kavanagh. And if anyone was thinking, Neve Kavanagh, I've heard that name somewhere before. Neve Kavanagh was also the 1993 winner of the Eurovision Song Contest for Ireland with a song called In Your Eyes, which is something you don't want a laser to be. I've checked and I'm pretty sure it's not the same person. Now, second up, we have our FameLab Germany winner, Hansa Yasar, as well as being an anagram of zany hearsay. Hanze is a PhD student at the Helmholtz Institute for Pharmaceutical Research in Saarland. That's HIPS for short. She's working on an all-gain, no-pain method of needleless vaccination. But when not doing that, Hanze says she still dreams, as she has done since she was 5 years old, of travelling to Mars to find aliens there. Cheltenham may be approximately 33 million miles closer than Mars, but we've still got plenty of strange life forms and more of an atmosphere. Plus, there's no need for vaccination with or without needles. Brace yourself for an injection of energy and entertainment from our FameLab Germany champion, Hanze Yasar.
Hello. Dear ladies and gentlemen, please imagine how you go to the doctor to get an injection against the flu. And then the doctor comes and takes something like this, a syringe and a needle. It's quite terrifying, isn't it? So I have to admit that I'm really afraid of this needle. And I guess some of you are afraid of this. But no worries, because I'm working on a method to remove this horrible needle and allow a completely painless vaccination. So how is that possible? I guess you all know the story about the Trojan horse. Let me explain just briefly. Once upon a time, we had some soldiers keen to invade into a city named as Troy. The city Troy was surrounded by a wall protecting the city, and inside the city near the entry, there were some guards sitting protecting as well. And the only way to invade into the city for the soldiers was hiding in a horse made of wood, that we today know as the Trojan horse. It's good for us because my project has exactly the same principle as the Trojan horse, because I want to invite these kind of vaccines or drugs into the skin. But skin is like the wall surrounding Troy. On the skin, we also have a lot of hairs here, actually everywhere, directing into the skin. And inside the skin, we have millions of guards or immune cells protecting us from these kind of invaders. So to bring them into the skin, I need something similar to the Trojan horse. And as my Trojan horse, I'm using these kind of chemical substances that we call as polymers. Now I can take my vaccines, hide them inside the polymer, and the polymer is now acting as a smuggler and protector for my vaccine. The whole structure we call as a nanoparticle. And this nanoparticle is so extremely small that we can't see it. It is 100,000 times smaller than a single hair. And since it is smaller than a hair, I can take this little tiny thing, put onto the skin, and it will migrate along the hairs inside the skin where it's kindly welcomed by the guards. So ladies and gentlemen, if you go in future to the doctor, you don't need to be scared at all, because this needle, you won't need it anymore. So just remove it and say bye-bye. Because you will take the nanoparticles for the vaccines, apply onto the skin like that, and just lotion it easily by using a vaccine cream. So ladies and gentlemen, please keep in mind, research can open a new terrain for a future without any pain. Thank you.
So please be careful for the next one.
Hanze, that's a great talk. Thank you very much. Selfish questions again, I apologise, but I love the science that you're all talking about. Nanoparticles are brilliant, and I'm a nanochemist as well, but obviously there are lots of unknowns of using nanoparticles as well. They can potentially sort of interfere, you know, with the sort of cell contents of our body. What do you think, you know, our main hurdles are, and actually how are we going to overcome those?
What do you exactly mean to overcome?
So there's a lot of potential risk that we don't yet know about with using nanoparticles. Mm. We've heard about things like, you know, asbestos dust that can cause real problems, which we didn't know about back then.
Yeah.
You know, what are the hurdles? How long will it take for us to test all of that?
I mean, there's still a lot of concerns in the population regarding the nanotechnology itself, but you know, the nanoparticles or nanostructures that we're preparing will be for pharmaceutical research that we will apply onto the skin or human body. So what we try to use actually biopolymers, which are completely biodegradable and biocompatible. So if this would enter into this into the body anywhere to the targeted places, so it doesn't matter if it's the skin or the stomach, The polymers are degraded by some enzymatic degradation or via hydrolysis, also kind of reaction taking place, or by any microorganism sitting inside a gut or stomach. So this is what we are actually focusing on, to use completely biopolymers, which are biodegradable and biocompatible, to actually avoid any side effects later on.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Hansi. I really enjoyed your presentation. I enjoyed your use of props. I'm interested, once those polymers start to break down, how long do they take to break down? And can you control the rate at which they break down?
Yeah, we can actually control them, because it actually depends on the polymers that we are using. So we can use polymers with different chain lengths. So if we have, for example, a large nanoparticles that we have prepared, and we can also take some other polymers that we can put onto the first polymer, and then the one on the surface will first degrade, and then the second one, and so we can control the release of the drug inside the polymer. And with this, we can also control the time of release.
Okay, once more for our polymer polymath and her Trojan horse, Hansi Yassar. Nice report. Right, got FameLabbers from 27 nations and multiple vaccinations taking part today. And third up in this third Tremi final is our Portuguese winner, Ana Amada Moreira. We're okay with a Portuguese Armada, but a Spanish one we don't tend to like over here. Now, she's a neuroscience PhD student in molecular neurosciences based in Lisbon. Ana says studying coexists with life as a musician, playing guitar in Portuguese punk pop outfit Ana Chicks, who I think are reminiscent of an all-female B-52s. They like playing live in strange places and have opened for the Arctic Monkeys. Woo. Now, we're not doing that or neuroscience-y things. Ana is attempting to set up a festival of empowerment and self-expression for teenage girls. And we're not doing any of those. There was the small matter of winning FameLab. Applause, please, for our axe-wielding, analytical Ana chick, Ana Amada Moreira.
So the other day, I woke up with an ABBA song in my head, and I have no idea why. I actually really like the song, but I haven't heard it in a long time, and yet I still know it by heart. On the other hand, I find it very hard to remember where I parked my car every day, or what I had to lunch yesterday. So this got me wondering, why on earth am I able to recall hundreds, if not thousands of songs, but have such a hard time remembering important things? Well, it's actually because music is rather complex, and our brain has an easier job memorizing complex stuff rather than simple stuff, because it stores things in boxes. Let's imagine you're listening to a song. Here we'll have our first box. Don't be confused, the brain will be turned that way, okay? Our first box, which will be the auditory cortex. The auditory cortex will decide if that information we're getting is music or not. If it is, we'll move on to our second box in the front of the brain, the frontal cortex, which will analyze things like rhythm and tone of the song. But songs have lyrics, lyrics have meaning, so we go back there, to the region that interprets speech, also active when listening to a song. But I bet you're probably singing along, especially if you like the song, aren't you? So one step to the side, and we have the zone responsible for speech production, also active. But that's not all, because when you listen to a song, you're probably imagining it in your head, and you're thinking of that amazing music video, and you're thinking about your memories with that song. So let's go to the back of the brain, where your visual cortex will also be active. But there's more, because music makes us move to the beat, and we can't help it but move around while listening to a song. So let's go to the middle of the brain, where our final box will be our motor cortex, also active. Now, we have all these boxes, and they're not independent from each other. They have pathways that connect them. And every time you hear that song one more time, all these pathways will be reinforced. They'll be so reinforced, in fact, that one day you'll be doing your thing, you'll be living your life, and without thinking about it, two or three words of the lyrics will pop up in your mind. And there you go again, because all these boxes will light up and you'll get the song stuck in your head again. Now, to wrap things up, and because I want you to randomly remember me forever, I'm gonna get a song stuck in your head. Are you ready? When you hear a song, it just messes with your cortex, auditory to the frontal, to the motor, to the visual, and back again. Come on, let's go, it's fun. There's not a soul out there, no one to hear my prayer. You can clap. Yeah. Gimme, gimme, gimme my after midnight. Won't somebody help me get this song off my head? Give me my brain after midnight. Please just let me focus on this Fame Lab instead. Thank you very much.
Thank you, that was very enjoyable. It's obviously a bit of a paradox that the more complex you make something, the easier it is to remember, and that's quite an interesting idea. To what extent can this be applied into educational contexts to help people to remember information?
Well, I think that the main thing about education is that everybody has a different way of learning. And we have to acknowledge that. We cannot just teach math in the exact same way to everybody. We have to learn what does that person like, what are they biologically designed to learn better, and find an individual way, I guess, of teaching matters so they're fun and that people can actually memorize them better.
Do you think music has a role to play?
Oh, yeah, I do. Because really, if you think about it, who here has seen The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air? It's a very complex rap song, and I still know it. I bet most of you still know it, too. So, yeah.
Great, thank you.
That was fabulous. I feel like I'm on the X Factor, and I feel like they had like boop. So I'm interested in, you know, we're talking about like remembering complex things. So I'm wondering, to what extent is this phenomenon that you're describing unique to music, mm-hmm. or are there other phenomena that kind of activate different parts of the brain and therefore are more memorable?
Well, it's not really specific to music. It's not even very logical that it is specific to music, because we don't really need to memorize music to survive. But actually, if you think about it, memorizing patterns is actually very important for human survival. If you think about bush people, if you see the wind blow, you're going to have to guess there's a tiger out there, because otherwise you'll die. Mm. So yeah, patterns are very important to figure out. And music just falls into that box, I guess. So all the different and complex stuff that we learn independently of the form, they will also activate several different brain regions, so they'll be easier to memorize.
So effectively, in terms of education, like if I am learning something and at the same time I'm activating different parts of my brain by jumping up and down, I'm more likely to remember it?
I don't know if that's so straightforward like that.
I'm going to try it in my office.
If you get emotionally involved in learning something, well, then you get more brain involvement, so yeah.
Circumstances, I should say thank you for the music to Anna. Thank you. I don't know if you saw the news today, but they've just sung together for the first time in 40 years.
Thank you.
Anna Almada Morera, also an anagram of "and I am a rare aroma." Now, when you've got pyramids that are 4,500 years old, having had Fame Lab for 7 years may not sound much, but Egypt time, and still the competition has kept going. This year's winner is Dina El Zahiri. As well as being an anagram of Dozy Hairline, Dina is someone who does, well, she does a lot of different things. She's a fourth-year biotech student at Cairo University, researching using nanoparticles to treat wastewater, and the effects of new compounds on tumor cells, and nutritional genomics. She's also science director of a computer company, a trainer at the Arabic
Okay. Deep darkness surrounding you everywhere. Freezing temperature. And then you're stuck in a high mountain. And suddenly, you found yourself in a hospital and you lost the second part of your legs. Actually, that's what happened to our athlete. And he wasn't that depressed. All what he was thinking about, how to get a chance to get back to his own hobby. He wasn't convinced with those compensating devices. Yeah, it looks like a leg, but still it's a kind of a load and I cannot act normally. I wanted to develop a device that looks and acts like the normal leg. How? This is bionics. Bio for biology and onics for electronics. To attain such thing, you are going to depend on two main things. First of all, we're going to make a deep analysis for the human motion while walking, running, and jumping, and see all the external forces that affect our leg. Secondly, we're going to make a precise size and shape for this leg so I can make something fit my patient. But remember when I said it's a kind of a load? So I want my brain to control this bionic leg. Assume with me that this part of my leg is the normal one, and this part is the bionic leg. They found even after the accident, the nerves are still alive and connected by the brain and can send and receive messages. And in the bionic leg, we have something called electrode, something like a sensor. Feel those signals, capture them, and let the bionic leg move. Okay, but slow down. We have a problem out there. Those nerves are too weak, and the signals cannot be detected by the electrodes. And to solve this out, we are going to depend on muscles. The muscles over here are so strong. Once they contract, they send very strong signals that could be detected by the electrodes. And that's why we're going to make a rerouting process from the damaged area into this healthy area. And actually, after 4 months, they found that those nerves are still alive and can give much better signals to be detected by the electrodes. So okay, my bionic leg is ready to move. Hold on, I don't know where to move. That's why I'm going to use a microprocessor, a kind of a computer, translate what my mind wants me to do. Okay, I want to go forward, so I will operate the motor that's responsible for motion forward. This whole process is the turning point in the bionic's life, and actually, it helps our athlete to break much better records in mountain climbing. Because there is nothing called disabled human. Disability is in the technology, but the more we improve it, the more we erase this expression from humanity. Thank you so much.
Wow, Dina, I think, you know, all of those science fiction movies with the half robot, half human thing are definitely flashing before my eyes at the moment. So what I want to ask you about is, obviously bionics has been in kind of public consciousness a lot in terms of, you know, the development of the bionic eye, specifically the bionic hand. I guess I want to ask you to explain to us, what is the state of bionics now? If I, you know, lose a hand or a limb, can I go and get a bionic one, which will work?
Let me say it in a small sport story, actually. I was irritated to make this thing before in a competition, and the one next beside me, I was in an international conference, and they were talking about the whole session is about bionics. So I told her, I'm going to make a talk, and I'm so afraid. She said she get the skirt, and she showed me that she have two bionic knees, and her optic nerve in the left eye is a bionic. So I was like, I will do it, actually. So that it's applied, and a lot of people can work on it, starting with the terminus, because the more you are looking for a terminal part, the more it's easy, because you know you are going to deal with a small part of the nerve system. Okay. And by the way, this story is real. That's about Hutter. You can Google it and found his work. It's about a Biomes 2 factory, and you can see all the products and how he can deceive people because they thought he's really walking normal. Because actually, technology is not, you know, people use, the normal people, all of us, use technology to make our life easier. But actually, for disabled people, it makes it possible. And that's what science is for.
The future is here now.
Yeah.
That was a really great talk, and I love your use of props as well. I have a slightly stupid question, so forgive me for this. If you're trying to move something, you know, obviously a lot larger, like, you know, the lower part of a limb or something, would you need sort of a power source, a sort of external power source for that? And in that case, how do you charge it up? Do you, what
goes on there?
Let's deal with me like I'm an engineer and I'm working with wires, okay? It's all about electric wires. And the nerve is a biological wire. So when you need to extend this or I'm going to have something much deeper, okay? It's all about looking for the centers because I'm going to make an MRI imaging to see the bones and how, as I said before, in the external forces, how my leg gonna move. And I see the healthy centers. So they are going to see the healthy centers that contain a much better nerves and work with it. Like and the more you need to detect those signals, the more you are going to use sensors and electrodes.
Okay, but in terms of sort of powering, is that not
very briefly?
Yeah, I was just kind of curious, but don't worry, we'll chat later.
Yeah, you said, what the hell? Let's leave that conversation dangling about. Okay, one more time, please, for Egyptian champion and bionic woman, Dina Al-Zahiri. I think you've got a guilt. I notice almost all your questions start with, I'm sorry, and this is a really stupid question. Forgive me, but it's judge guilt. Right, okay. Right, so that was definitely no wipeout, but will our surfer girl make it through to the final? Only our judges will tell. We'll find out soon enough because we're now halfway through this Tremi final, 5/6 of the way through all 27 FameLab as we're seeing today. And our midpoint is another bastion of the ancient world, Greece. Their FameLab winner is the small and senior Leandros Lamnis. That's not a description, it's an anagram. Leandros Lamnis, small and senior. And in reality, he's reasonably tall, not that senior because he's still a medical student and has a recent past as what he calls a nerd anti-hero. Leandros used to be big into internet poker and illegal graffiti. Now he's involved in the European Youth Parliament and the Model United Nations. He's also working on a startup attempting to counteract Greece's increasing bureaucracy, although there's a lot of forms to fill in before he can get it started. There's no such red tape and paperwork to take part in FameLab. He may have needed, though, some of his poker skills to get this far. He's not quite got a full house, but now it's time to go all in for our FameLab Greece champion, Leandros Lamnis.
What's happening right now is unbelievable. Could it be that the time of the semifinals has come without me even realizing? Last thing I remember is coming back from training and going straight to sleep. Sleep is divided into two phases, REM sleep and non-REM sleep, with REM being the one with the much more intensive brain activity. This is when we see dreams, 3 to 7 each day, yet we forget 95% of them, especially within the first 10 minutes. Our left brain hemisphere, which controls logic action, slows down. And that's why in dreams we rarely can read text or see the time. Wait a minute, my watch seems blurry. The posters around are blurry as well. But most importantly, why can I not remember how I came here? That's it, I am watching a nightmare. This classic one, you see, it's time something that makes you nervous approaches. When I was having my finals, I saw that I took the test unprepared. At the semi-finals of FameLab, I see that, so I am in REM sleep right now, which stands for rapid eye movement. People that wasn't sleeping can see my eyelids flapping and my eyes dancing back and forth, hence the name REM. But they can't see these movements because at this stage, our body blocks the production of some hormones necessary for muscle movement, therefore paralyzing us in order to protect us from our own dangerous fantasies. But why haven't I woken up yet? I mean, I know I'm in a bed right now, but I can feel the bed sheets on my fingertips. I am in a lucid dream. Now, lucid dreams are dreams where the dreamer realizes he's part of a dream without waking up, though, and is further able to change the dream and reshape it however he wants. Now, this gives you the ability to do things you want in real life, but can't due to many physical obstacles. You can travel to the most exotic places, fulfill your each and every materialistic desire. You can feel the sensation of flying, or even talk to loved ones that aren't still alive. In terms of brain activity, normal and lucid dreams share many common characteristics. Nevertheless, in lucid dreams, some specific areas of the brain, especially at the frontal lobe of the cerebral cortex, which are responsible for self-evaluation, evaluation of thoughts and emotions, and self-realization, seem much more active, which explains why the transition from a normal to a lucid dream is a product of realization, and not the use of senses, as it is if you wake up to an alarm clock, for instance. So, despite the beauty of dreams, we shouldn't forget to make every day our reality dreaming, and not dreams are reality. After all, dreams and reality are easily distinguished, right? I wasn't wearing my glasses all this time. But if I can see the time, if I can read the posters, then am I dreaming or?
Thank you very much, Leandros. I'm really curious about your talk, particularly because I'm the kind of person where you can wake me up, have a full conversation with me, and I will fall back to sleep and have no recollection that that has happened. So I have a slightly wider question. Why do we dream?
Why do we dream? That's a great question. And as funny as it sounds, we have actually given answers to so many questions of the universe, but we can't really give a definite answer in that, mainly because in order to know if someone is dreaming or not, you actually have to wake them up and ask them. And the only thing that we can do scientifically right now is to have brain scans and electroencephalographies and all that kind of stuff. They can actually measure whether someone is in REM sleep, so if someone has the potential to dream, but the one thing that we have to do in order to know that they are actually dreaming or why they're dreaming is to wake them up and ask them, which obviously is not the best scientific way to do things.
I like that, yeah.
Thanks for that. There were moments when I wasn't sure if I was dreaming or not, so thank you. I think your presentation style was very absorbing and you pulled us right in. I've got a question, and that is, a lot of us as scientists, we know why we study this stuff. It's because it really fascinates us. For the public, why should this study be done? I mean, why are we interested in this?
Okay, first of all, I think knowing that you can actually create a virtual reality to do things that you want is entertaining. Like, I would want to do it. I think everyone, if they knew how to do it, they would do it. But there's more than this. And that's because many times, like many conditions that have to do with psychology, many people, for example, that a woman who was raped, she's now seeing multiple nightmares, and she is suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder. Now, such a thing, if it can be trained for her to do it, it's going to help her to fight the nightmares in real time and not actually have to go to psychotherapy and try to do it like, you understand what I'm saying? Like, understood. Post-traumatic disorder is one thing that really can be helped by this, but there's also the entertaining part of knowing that you can do things in your sleep and create the universe as you want it for you.
Can I quickly ask you a question before Quentin edges? He's edging.
We can do both.
So I was fascinated by, you know, this idea that we need to protect ourselves from, and I'm going to quote you, our own dangerous fantasies while we sleep. That's terrifying. But my question is, what's the hormone that paralyzes us, and what happens if it's there when I wake up?
There's actually a very bad thing that happens.
I'm sorry, I'm just asking for it.
It's like, I don't remember how it's called, but it's a condition that you're actually
sleep paralysis.
That's it. That's sleep paralysis. That you're again in this hybrid dream and awake situation, but you cannot move your body because the hormones that paralyze your muscles are yet not activated, and so you're there. And apart from not being able to move, you also think that there is a dark figure behind you. And that's really a scary experience. I haven't. Yeah. I have lived it right now. Yeah. So there's the good thing to experience a lucid dream, which is lovely. And there is the bad thing that is experiencing sleep paralysis, which is terrible.
Okay, clap loud enough to wake the dead for Leandros Lemnis, a Greek champion. He's wearing an REM t-shirt. We had a B-52s reference before. They combined on shiny Happy People hit single 1986. We're throwing in the 80s music trivia absolutely free. Right, Sophia, so good. And so we come to our Bulgaria champion, Petar Eftimov, a veterinary surgeon and assistant professor of embryology and histology at Sofia University. Petar's also finished off his PhD in molecular biology. But he says that even though his research and teaching is very demanding, he manages to have so many hobbies that he wonders how he finds time to work. They include swimming, stargazing, cycling, and somehow successfully securing victory in FameLab Bulgaria. Now, down the years, I've heard a lot of reasons why people enter FameLab, but Petar's is a new one for me. He says he wanted to show his students that molecular biology is not just a compendium of 3 to 5 letter weird abbreviations, but an amusing and exciting field of exploration. OMG, hope you agree with our winner from Bulgaria, Petar Eftimov.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Do you know how many scientists have trouble in naming their discoveries? Think of Leonard of Quirm from the famous Discworld novel of Terry Pratchett and his going under the water safety device. Right, this is a submarine. I was faced with the same problem when I started studying biology. For instance, the muscle I use to point with my forefinger, his name is Extensor Digiti Primi Longus. Quite a long name. And apparently some scientists are more inventive in finding names for what they invent. So can you guess, what is the relationship between molecular biology and video games? Both are very addictive, I can tell you. And they share certain characters. I will speak of them now. Do you like Pokemons? Yes, you like them. Looks like a nice guy, but in molecular biology, it turns out to be a villain. Yes, it's a great villain because he's responsible for cancer development. The Pokemon backronym coined by Pier Paolo Pandolfi stands for POC, erythroid, myeloid, ontogenic factor, a factor that works well during development, embryonic development, but after that, it may turn normal cells into neoplastic. In fact, silencing Pokemon leads to the programmed cell death called apoptosis. Without his leadership, bad cells die, they commit suicide like orcs without Sauron. You get it? And prepare yourself because even a big villain comes. That's Diablo, you know Diablo. He is definitely a bad guy, but if you want to kill him, yes, like that, like burn him, shall I do that? No, because I made a promise not to burn to burn anything on stage. And there is a more substantial reason, because he actually protects us by activating apoptosis of tumor cells. In fact, even now there are ongoing studies on drugs called Diablo mimetics, which can prevent several types of cancer, including hepatocellular carcinoma, Hodgkin lymphoma, breast, lung cancer, and many more. So, speaking in the field of science, do not be hasty to condemn, but judge not by the name, but by the deeds. And if you want to know how a sonic hedgehog may interfere with your fate, you just give me another 3 minutes. Thank you. He's not a devil, he's an angel. Yes. He's smiling, can't you?
Thanks. I enjoyed your references to characters that we know and understand, so you didn't have to explain too much more. Yeah. What is this understanding of these particular, are we talking about molecular structures?
Yes, we speak about tumor suppressor factor, which is Diablo, and a major oncogenic switch factor, which is Pokemon. But in reality, the things are more complex. In fact, how many people are there? I think about 50. That's not enough, because in order to explain the whole pathway of acting of Diablo, we need like 300 people. If every one of them is one molecule or receptor for that molecule, we need roughly 300 people. So it's far from clinical approach, but still keeps your fingers crossed.
Wow, I think scientists are sometimes accused of not being kind of creative, but when you see how they name what they discover, that is definitely scientifically disprovable. I'm really interested in the mechanism of Diablo and what we kind of know about it. Like, what do you think, what is the quintessential study that we would have to do for you to kind of get to a deeper understanding of the way Diablo operates in a cancer system?
Yes, Diablo actually is a tumor suppressor which is stored in our mitochondria, the cell power plant. and he's held in prison there, like behind the bars. Once released, he, let's say, summons his warriors of hell. That's specific enzymes, which name is caspases. And these caspases, due to several changes in cellular membranes, releases factors which lead tumor cells, presumably, to commit suicide. But the most important thing about that is the Diablo mimetic drugs, which use, like here we see, if we presume that I'm a cancer cell and he's Diablo mimetic drug, he will shake my hand now. And by shaking my hand, he will put me on the ground, yes. So that's the most simple way to explain Diablo mechanism.
Wow. We've had Diablo, we've had Pokemon, we've had Sonic the Hedgehog. Can we please thank the incendiary, but not too incendiary, Petar Efimov. And Petar did ask me about anagrams of his name, and the best I can come up with is formative pet. My formative pet was my little cat Biscuit that I had when I was 6 years old. Right, now, antepenultimately, it's across the Atlantic we go to our FameLab USA winner, Elissa Ocko. Now, every country does FameLab slightly differently, and in the States, it's sponsored and partly organized by NASA. I'm so happy that NASA have got involved with this. We're very proud of something that started in Cheltenham, having captured the excitement of NASA. And they had a theme of exploring Earth and beyond. So you might have expected the winner to be an astrobiologist or a rocket engineer. But actually, Elissa is a climate scientist with EDF, which over there stands for the Environmental Defense Fund. Over here, it's a French energy company. Elissa says she's committed to communicating climate change to non-experts, something that in America is largely done by Bill Nye, the science guy, and nobody else. And it helps that her true passion is designing infographics that can get really big ideas across visually. I say it helps, but there's not really much chance to use an infographic in a FameLab presentation. Or is there? Let's watch and find out from our FameLab USA champion, Elissa Ocko.
Why do we sleep with blankets? Habit is a part of it, but even monkeys will choose to sleep with a blanket if provided the option. Blankets are comforting, prevent distractions, and the extra warmth helps us fall asleep. But blankets aren't always good. Too much warmth from a blanket throughout the night is actually very disruptive to our natural sleep cycle. The Earth also has an insulating blanket around it, an atmosphere filled with heat-trapping gases. And similar to our blankets, there's a fine line between being helpful versus harmful. For example, Earth would be 60 degrees Fahrenheit cooler and frozen without greenhouse gases. But human activities are continually thickening Earth's natural blanket, and the extra warmth is harming ecosystems and societies worldwide. Activities like driving cars and farming emit several pollutants into the atmosphere. But because each pollutant contributes to warming in different ways, Earth's blanket is actually more like a quilt, where every pollutant is a different patch. My research as a climate scientist is to determine which pollutants matter the most so we can shrink this quilt and prevent catastrophic future warming. There are three ways that we use to determine how a pollutant impacts warming. Number one, intensity. Intensity is how effective a pollutant is at trapping heat, or the thickness of the patch. Carbon dioxide, the most well-known greenhouse gas, would actually be as thin as a bedsheet, not that potent per pound. But black carbon, commonly referred to as soot, would be a patch a mile thick, because it is a million times more effective at trapping energy than CO2. Number two, quantity. Quantity is how much of it we create, or the size of the patch. So black carbon might be the thickest patch you've ever seen, but if it was the size of your hand, then CO2 would be a patch the size of a large apartment, because we are currently emitting thousands of times more CO2 than black carbon every year. Number three, duration. Duration is how long a pollutant lasts in the atmosphere, or how long the patch stays on the quilt. CO2 can virtually last forever, and so those apartment-sized bedsheets are actually building up over time. But black carbon, the hand-sized mile-long patch, would actually disintegrate from your blanket after about a week. So while we've just envisioned the world's most unusual quilt, the combination of intensity, quantity, and duration help us understand why we must reduce emissions of CO2 to prevent warming for centuries, but why we also must reduce emissions of black carbon to immediately reduce warming during our lifetimes. Because I have a dream that one day my children will live in a world that is not too hot and not too cold, but just right. And when I dream, I sleep with my quilt. Thank you.
Hi. Hi. So I'm going to ask the elephant in the room question.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously science communication is incredibly important, but particularly at the moment, client scientists have found themselves in the middle of an international debate, and particularly in the US, that debate is raging, and where we seem to not be winning the points that we need with the public audience. Where do you feel that we are really going wrong on communicating issues of climate to lay audiences across the globe?
Yeah, I think that's a really good question, especially because I'm from the US, and out of any country, it's probably that issue is more prominent than other places. I think that one of the major challenges has been the media, in terms of when you talk about an issue, you like to present a balanced view of, you know, what the state of knowledge is. And so a lot of times there would be a scientist talking about how humans are causing climate change, and then a scientist saying, oh no, it's, you know, it's natural cycles or it's the sun. And so having equal weight for those two sides is not at all representative of how scientists actually feel about the issue, based on, you know, thousands of research studies that have been published in the peer-reviewed literature over the past few years. 99%, over 99%, agree that climate change is mainly caused by humans. So there really is no debate within the scientific community. It's a challenge of dealing with it, this kind of communication in platforms that originally deal with challenges in a different kind of way than science. And so that's, I probably could keep going, but I know that
May the force be with you.
Lisa, that was a really great talk. Thank you so much. I really love your blanket quilt thing as well.
I sewed it myself.
Analogy. Oh, amazing.
Sixth grade sewing skills. Don't come close to it.
It's really cool. And so obviously your subject matter is incredibly topical and can inform policy decisions.
Absolutely.
Are you involved in that, and do you feel that that's something that scientists from all ranges of, you know, research should be involved in? Can you tell us your thoughts on that?
Excellent question. It's when I was getting my PhD, it was very important to me to be involved in communication and policy. And so when looking for postdocs, I wanted something that was more untraditional that would involve me in those aspects. And so I work at the Environmental Defense Fund, which is an advocacy organization for environmental issues. It's worldwide, and it gives me the opportunity to provide our best available science to policy decisions. So for example, methane, in terms of reducing methane emissions from various sectors, I'm very involved in the science that, in terms of our understanding of the best available science at EDF, and then I work with lawyers and economists, and they work with Obama and the Obama administration, and now we've finally gotten through a climate action plan for dealing with methane from natural gas and oil systems in the US. And so we, you know, directly had influence on that with the Obama administration. Then he worked with Canada, and now they're in agreement too. And so it's really exciting to not only be able to do the research behind this topical issue, but also be able to, you know, influence those kind of really important decisions.
Absolutely, thank you.
Fine, and finally, how does this map onto the incoming Trump administration? No, don't answer that, Elissa. Elissa, can we please thank Elissa Occo, our American champion? Show your blanket approval, please. She's come this far, but will she go USA all the way to the final? We will find out soon enough. Now, Elissa has the shortest name of anyone in this Tremi final, and as random luck would have it, next we have the person with the longest name. Elissa, 10. Abdimanyu Veerakumarasivam, 25. All right. Now, a geneticist specializing in work on bladder cancer, Abdi is also out to bridge the gap between the scientific community and the public in Malaysia, something he says has precious few people trying to cross in either direction. He's already taken big strides by chairing the Young Scientist Network for the Academy of Sciences in Malaysia. He's gone even further across the divide by entering and winning FameLab, and now he's just a few steps away from being in the international final. But will he wake it? Please welcome our Malaysian champion, Abdi Manyu Veerakumarasivam.
In the last 5 seconds, two individuals have found out that they have cancer, and one life has been lost. That is our battle against cancer. But what is cancer? Cancer cells are just like normal cells that have acquired specific DNA mutations, or what we call as DNA damage, that equip these cancer cells with superpowers. But what are these superpowers? The first, the ability of cancer cells to be resistant to therapy. The other, to be able to grow faster than normal cells. And third, to spread across the body through a process called metastasis. But we have been able to design and develop viruses, yes, the scary viruses, engineer them safely to be able to equip them with superpowers to combat this cancer. We often view cancer as a huge blob of homogeneous mass, but what it actually is that it is a multiple clusters of cancer cells that coexist and continuously co-evolve. So when a patient undergoes chemotherapy, radiotherapy, or surgery, what usually happens is if the cancer cells appear to have shrunk or completely disappeared, normally it is that the majority of cancer cells may have been destroyed. There are resistant cancer cells that appear, and they are like ticking bombs. Given some time, they will develop into highly resistant and aggressive cancers. But we're able to design viruses that specifically target these cancer cells. What it do is that they infect these cancer cells and hijack the protein-making machinery of these cancer cells and to make more viruses. And before the cancer cell can divide, these viruses grow a lot faster than the cancer cells. And these baby viruses will then break these cancer cells and then infect the other cancer cells that is in the body. However, most people die from cancer because of the ability of cancer cells to evade into distant sites in a process called metastasis. And this is because they're able to evade the natural kryptonite, the human immune system. And really, no superhero story can end without an exposure of some sexy body parts. For example, cancer cells from the intestines have actually migrated and invaded into the liver and the lung. But these viruses not only directly kill cancer cells, what they do is that they are able to track and activate the immune system so that they can together battle against the cancer and finally kill these cancer cells. Although there are various advances in surgery, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and new forms of therapy, including the power to harness the viruses to be able to stop cancer growth, resistance, as well as metastasis, prevention is better than cure. 1/3 of all cancers can be avoided if we actually modified our lifestyles and prevented the damage to the environment so that it can inhibit DNA damage. Therefore, it's extremely important as science advances, we also need to communicate and celebrate science a lot better so that we can increase public awareness as well as to effect political change. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that talk. That was really interesting. I actually did an engineering superheroes talk this morning for schools, and I talked about engineering viruses. It's about as close as we'll get to a nanobot, really, isn't it? So you talked about these viruses that we can kind of, you know, reprogram, I suppose. Right. What's our ideal virus, and are there any that we absolutely cannot use for this purpose?
So in general, I think the whole idea, I mean, it's quite funny, right? The juxtaposition that viruses also cause cancer. And so we normally wouldn't want viruses that integrate into the human genome. And so there are multiple viruses that have actually been used. In fact, the EU in January 2016 approved the first FDA-approved drug, iMLYGIC, or Telimogen Laharparvec, which is specifically designed to melanoma cancer, and where it's been able to show the ability to directly increase survival rates. In the context of what I do, I'm actually using a chicken virus. So a chicken virus that's quite pathogenic to chickens, but they have absolutely no effect on humans. And so using recombinant technology to modify the viruses so that they specifically target the cancer cells.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thanks, Abby.
Thank you.
I enjoyed that you had spoken about what scientists are doing, you and your work, but then also spoke a little bit about what we can do about these. So can you tell us a little bit more? I mean, so much this about in particular the cancers that you're talking about. What are the lifestyle issues that you're referring to?
So I think the typical lifestyle issues such as smoking and alcohol, and there are lots of dietary, you know, even losing some weight, I think, you know, will actually help, as well as occupational hazards. But I was trying to talk another extra bit because we know about vaccines today. They're really effective vaccines, but the issue is the cultural acceptability. We might have, you know, affordable, accessible, and acceptable drugs, but the issue of cultural acceptability, where science is perceived very differently, a lot of views in the East, where I come from, science may be perceived as Western domination and another way of continuing their domination. So it's really important for scientists in our region to and communicators to work together to be able to share that science is actually, you know, universally acceptable and should really, you know, help to change and reduce that social and, you know, equity divide that's in the world.
Can we get an attacking immunological fight cancer T-shirt?
Oh, yeah, sure. Great. In fact, the American Society of American Clinical Oncology Conference that just happened last week has shown that the viruses, the first virus that was used, the herpes simplex virus, now can be used with PD-L1 checkpoint inhibitors. And so the realization of immunotherapy, you know, in the treatment of cancer in the context of melanoma has completely realized. So, yeah, I think there's obviously an opportunity to work on some T-shirts.
Sign me up.
Timing, go viral with your applause, please, for our Malaysian champion, Abdi Manisya Hussein. 26 down, one to go. Good job, because the stage is getting a bit messy now. One to go, and our final FameLab winner is from Hong Kong, Chloe Fung. Now, it is just chance that Chloe is last, but actually, there is something different about her. As she confesses in her biography, she is an art student going undercover in science. Although she's studying biomedical science, her secret mission is to spread the love of poetry and drive her fellow students crazy with random philosophical questions. It's all part of Chloe's fervent belief that the humanities and sciences need each other and that together they give us a deeper understanding of ourselves and our world. What's even more is amazing is how much of that deeper understanding you can get from just 3 minutes with the right person. Huge applause, please, for our final FameLab International Tremi finalist and Hong Kong champion, Chloe Fung.
Imagine a burglar breaking and entering into your house, holding a knife at your neck, saying, "From now on, you're not gonna work for anyone else but me. After you're done working for me, I'll kill you." That's what happens when a virus attacks your cells using its own DNA. DNA is a blueprint for making proteins, and viruses are essentially DNA wrapped in viral proteins. A type of virus known as retrovirus attacks our cells by inserting its own DNA in the middle of our own. It then bosses the cell to make a new army of viruses which burst and kill your cell. Now they're off to find other victims. That's the viral attack mode, but viruses can also take on another mode of action. Back to our scenario. Our burglar can actually sneak past your defenses, sit on your couch, and pretend to be family. How? The viral DNA can actually just sit there in between your DNA, lay low, do nothing at all, until it decides it's time. It's time to switch back to attack mode. You know, smart burglars are really picky with their victims, and so are viruses. Depending on the strain, viruses go for your immune cells, your skin cells, always a particular type of cells, but not every single one of your cells. But if the retrovirus infects the cells that become an embryo, which go on to become a whole new human being, then every single one of the cells of that person will have viral DNA. So will their children, their grandchildren, and so on. And that is exactly what has happened to each and every one of us. That's right. Due to infection of our ancestors, each cell in our body has viral DNA. But don't panic, okay? Because DNA itself accumulates a lot of mutations over time, which can alter their function. And so can viral DNA. And due to the defects they have picked up, these viral DNA in our cells, they have lost their function to switch to attack mode. Some of them have even been enslaved by our bodies to help us function. Viruses can be helpful instead of destructive. When we were embryos, we needed to develop a physical attachment to our mothers in order to excrete wastes and absorb nutrients from her. Viral proteins help develop this attachment. And sometimes our mother's bodies think we are foreign invaders, and her immune system proceeds to destroy us. And it is viral proteins that suppress this immune system and protect us. Yes, we know viral proteins and viruses. Viruses are responsible for a lot of destructive diseases, but they can also be a vital part of human life. Thank you.
Thanks, Jay. That was really exciting. I'm fascinated by this idea that we've got this DNA sitting inside us, and in fact, we've essentially evolved to live with it.
Yes.
What, apart from telling us how some of it has got actually has positive impacts on our health,
yes.
what else is the importance of us understanding this component of viruses in our own DNA or in our own systems?
Yes, do you know that in humans, we haven't found any of the viral DNA that can switch back to attack mode, but in other animals like pigs and koalas, we've actually found some that can emerge back from our DNA and become infectious again. So by researching into these viral DNA within humans, we look further into why and how they become infectious and how not, and prevent further infections.
Fascinating, yeah. Thank you.
Welcome.
Chloe, I have a question. So I think in the public consciousness, viruses get a really bad rap, right? So Zika and Ebola and SARS and MERS and all these really scary viruses.
Yeah, right.
And then we also hear about kind of the therapeutic or evolutionary benefits of viruses. How are we gonna convince the public to use immunotherapy when we spend the whole time terrifying them about dangerous viruses? Do you think we have a job to do to kind of get out there as virus fans?
Yes. You know, the important thing is to remember, you know, as science communicators, is to tell people that these viruses, the bacteria, the molecules in our bodies, they're neutral. They're not on any side. They're not out to attack you. They're not terrorists. But they have their own agenda. So some viruses are good. Some viruses can cause disruptions in our bodies. Some viruses actually produce proteins that help us. And so we need to properly, classify which viruses they are before we start talking.
No, that was a really interesting talk. Thank you so much. Given what you do, obviously you are a scientist, as many of us are, and people think we sort of put our lab coats on, toddle into the lab, do a day's work and leave, you know. Obviously it's a much sort of longer process for you. So can you tell us a bit about the sort of time scales that you're working with your work? As an example, I can go into a lab, synthesize something and test it within the week. Mm-hmm. How about when you're working with something like viruses? Is there a lot of sort of cultivation involved? How long does it take to just look at one small thing?
To be honest, I'm not working with viruses. I'm still a student and at school, and I really, really love studying all kinds of biomedical things. But to reply to your question, how do we look at viruses? We look at them under a really...
In a very short amount of time.
In a very short amount of time. Well, we use a very high-tech microscope to look at them, and that's where
we physically look at them. Cool.
Okay, it's not via you, it's via us. Please thank our Hong Kong Chloe Fung champion and last fame labber of the day. So that is your lot. You've seen how brilliant they've been individually and collectively. Now comes the unenviable task of dividing them into two categories. Those who get to be on stage again tomorrow, and those who get to have the day off, relax, enjoy the festival, and generally lark around. It's not so bad not being one of the winners, but it is tricky. So Robert, Ronnie, Suze, off you go to reach a bit of high-speed consensus. And can we please send them on their way with some applause? And your last chance to yell names if you want to influence them. You can persuade them along the way. We'll see you in 10 minutes. Of course, there is almost no chance of influencing the judges by yelling because they can't really hear anything up here. But there is a chance to influence the result by what you do now, which is voting. I can see, looking at you, that you're a very sophisticated, smart, science-savvy audience, all except a sort of small few of you down there as well. So you should have no trouble pushing away the urge to vote for country or kinship or kind of like how they look. Just vote for who is best, who the audience deserves to see tomorrow night. Now, we've got a brilliant and sophisticated new way of doing this, which is by mobile phones. If you were here for the first heat, you'll know it catastrophically failed. So we've got an unsophisticated, old-fashioned and crude way of doing it, which is by your applause. So if we can get all nine Fame Labbers back up on stage, please. To some applause, if possible. So what I will do, as I've done in the previous ones, is once they're all assembled, we can have some fun if they can try and remember what order they came in, but it doesn't really matter. I will read out the names once, just to avoid the problem that you'll just vote for people on the grounds of a name you've heard before. And when I read out each name, just step forward when I do each name, because that way people are reminded who you are. Stand anywhere in the line you care to. And then we'll go through it again, and this time it's your applause, and we'll have a clapometer at the back measuring, and then we'll reveal the result later. So, in alphabetical order, just for fun, we're going to have Abdi Manu Virakumarasivam. Step forward or wave your hand, thank you. Remember, this is the voting's later, you don't need to applaud now. I mean, you can, it was great, and you whipped them up, but you've got to save that, so the applause is later, okay? So, this is just the first time, just to make sure there's no bias of order here, okay? So, we've had Abdi, that's fine. Now we'll have Ana Amada Moreira. Hey. Chloe Fung. Just keep something for seconds. Dina El-Zahiri from Egypt. They've got a lot of love in them. Hanze Yassar from Germany. Elissa Occo from the USA. Leandros Lamnis from Greece. Niamh Kavanagh from Ireland. And Petar Eftimov from Bulgaria. Nice piece of applause milking at the end. So, I will now read out their names one more time in a kind of random order, and this time it will be your vote that counts. So, let's do it just backwards. So, we'll start with Petar Eftimov from Bulgaria. That was good. The Fame Labbers are clapping each other. That's sweet. Niamh Kavanagh from Ireland. Remember, it's the volume of your applause that counts, not the cheers. No, the clapometer can't tell, obviously. Leandros Lamnis from Greece. From the USA, Elissa Occo. From Germany, Hanze Yassar. Our champion from Egypt, Dina El-Zahiri. So far, I'd say it's all about even, apart from the ones that were different. Chloe Fong from Hong Kong. Ana Amada Omerera from Portugal. And finally, Abdi Virakumarasivam from Malaysia. Thank you. So we know the results almost instantaneously, as usual. We'll save it now. While we're waiting for the judges, Those of you who are here at 1 and 2 will know this. We've got the idea of turning our panel from being 9 competing fame labbers into a coherent brain trust, able to tackle your science questions, whatever they might be on. Now, you can ask them about what you've just seen them doing on stage, because frankly, some of the judges' questions were a bit lame, and you might have better ones. Or you can ask them about anything in science. Why don't penguins' feet freeze? What happens when we sneeze? Why do people list things in threes? Whatever it is you want to ask, think about it now. We'll put the lights up if we can. Okay, we're going to go straight to the hand there in the middle. Microphone's coming in from your right.
First of all, thanks everybody for your talk. They're amazing. Seems like everything that you're doing can either help or save the world. So one thing I was curious about
we have a rule about not having people who are going to destroy the world on Fame Labs. It's just a strict policy.
It's a good rule. So one of my questions is about renewable energies and how they're not being used because they're kind of less efficient. So I'm wondering, is there, like, say, ways we can make them more efficient? Is there ways we can get more energy from the sun, say?
Okay, Alyssa might volunteer for that one.
Yeah, I'm happy to take a stab at that. So I wouldn't say that one of the main reasons why renewables aren't being used is because they're not as efficient, because even though theoretically solar cells, for example, can only be, let's say, 15% efficient, even so, there's so much sunlight that we're getting that even, you know, the sunlight hitting the whole world in 1 hour could power the whole world for a year. So it doesn't need to be perfectly efficient. It's, you know, we basically need a whole energy portfolio. We need a lot of different options, and especially as we wean ourselves off of fossil fuels. So there's a lot of different types of renewables, and so obviously wind and solar are the two main ones, and there's a lot of other challenges in the way with them being variable sources of energy. For example, if you have a lot of clouds, you're not gonna have as much sun. If you don't have a lot of wind, you're not gonna get as much power. Costs, when you have a new technology, costs are really high. They've come down tremendously over time for solar cells, for example, but there still is, you know, this, you know, it's newer, so it needs to take time for people to, you know, use it more. And I could go on more about that, but that's sort of my little sense of that, yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, Fame Lab is almost carbon neutral now. It's powered entirely by enthusiasm and caffeine. Okay, question at the back there, or comment, or whatever it might be.
Question for Peter. Why do we love fluffy kittens?
That's a very interesting question. Because
it certainly is, yes.
Yes, and most of you believe that because they are beautiful, they are nice, they purring like an interesting way, but the truth is a little bit darker. We and the cats share the common parasite. Yes, that's true. Its name is Toxoplasma, and Toxoplasma tends to make cysts in the brains of the higher mammals like us. So these cysts produce specific neuromediator that makes us happier. And we want more cats in order to propagate these parasites. So take it in your mind when you go and play with your cat. Of course.
Hang on, there's a supplementary hanging here, which is, are these cysts actually bad for us? I mean, are we just happy with the cats, or are we briefly happy and then we die horribly?
No. We live long and successful life, but we tend to have more cats. Yes, and obviously...
I'm catophobic. You have to explain this.
Yes, you're catophobic because you properly wash your hands after touching a cat. Okay.
I'm not sure for any Latin scholars, cataphobic is a real word, by the way.
Felinophobic is the right word.
Okay, question there. Hank, it's coming in on your left. Yep. Hello.
When I was younger, I thought I had superpowers because I was able to control my dreams. How many people have lucid dreams? Is it something common? And is it something that changes with age?
So, in fact, almost everyone has experienced lucid dreaming at least once in their life. Maybe some of us do not remember it, but the majority does have it. The thing is that you cannot actually do something so that you are sure to see a lucid dream, but you can increase the frequency by following methods like keeping a dream diary, or maybe by going to sleep and supporting the idea that I'm going to see a lucid dream. But as I said, it's more about realizing that you're in a dream. So maybe reality checking in your daily life is going to be transferred into your dreams, and then you're going to realize that you're dreaming, and then you're going to control it. It's similar to how Inception worked, we can say, in a way. So yeah, I don't think there's anything to do with AIDS. It's more about how you train your mind or how lucky you are if you're not training.
And is it useful as far as you're concerned? If we're lucidly dreaming or not lucidly dreaming, is there anything to be gained by that?
If it's useful or if it's
useful, yeah. I mean, is there an advantage in if you can lucidly dream, can you actually do something creative in your dreams? I've heard of people who sometimes solve problems in their dreams.
Oh, look, it's not like you can say that I want to see tomorrow tests questions answered. Like, all the information are inside your brain already. You can explore your brain. Some people, I think, some artists do it in a way that they try to create something, to create a world, so that they can elaborate on through their art. But of course, there's the obvious advantage of being able to control your dreams, that you can do whatever you want in them. It's similarly to how virtual reality machines are being so much popular at the moment. But imagine virtual machines, like, in a much better way, that is your dreams. Like, just compare how you feel when you're dreaming and how real it seems, no matter how crazy the dream is, and how a video game is. And just think how it would be to just have them at the same time.
Thank you. Okay, we've got a couple more. Gonna go there. Yep.
My question goes to, especially to Leandros, about dreams. And hence, in my 7 years old, I used to see 4D space in my dreams. I can't explain this to you how it was, because I can't do that. We are just able to explain 3D. But I used to see this 4D. And do you have an idea that where these dreams happen?
Why dreams? What do dreams mean?
Doing dream interpretation now as well.
Okay,
as a bonus,
so
yeah.
That's part of the psychology thing that I don't really know. But what I can say is that there are multiple theories of why we are dreaming. Of course, as I said in the question before, we can't really be sure of which is the correct one. But one of them says that in our mind, it's like our brain stores information, stores memories, and the noise of the storage is dreams. So that they do not have an actual meaning, but it's more of an epiphenomenon of what actually happens. And this that happens is the storage of memories. Now, there are psychologists that believe that dreams mean something. Another theory says that dreams are a way of the nature to prepare us for dangerous situations, because the most popular feeling in dreams is anxiety. And so it says that if I see in my dream that the bear is hunting me, then I'm going to be afraid and I'm going to be experienced of how to avoid the bear next time the bear is going to hunt me. So this gives me a survival advantage. So there are many theories, but you can pick whatever you want. You can pick that it has no meaning. You can pick that it has a psychological meaning. You can pick that it's just your mind preparing you for your future, to protect you or whatever. It's just something that, at least at the moment, we don't have a definite answer on.
I'm now really worried tonight I'm going to dream about being hunted by a bear in four-dimensional space. Right. There was a hand there. There was a hand there. You just put it down. That's great.
My question is for Anna. I always wonder why it is easy to remember every single mistake my husband did rather than remembering the good moments.
Well,
be diplomatic.
Does he always make mistakes while singing? That could probably explain it. No, but basically, regardless of the type of information, if you have strong emotions associated with that information, your brain will figure that, okay, you have this information. You're getting emotionally involved in it. Your brain thinks, ooh, emotions must be important. Let's memorize it. So that's why you remember music that you associate with good moments of your life or bad moments of your life, and your memories that are more emotional get etched into your mind. I hope that answered, and I hope it was a good answer. I'm not sure, so yeah.
If it was a bad answer, she'll remember it. That's Okay, got time for just a couple more. We got one down here, but you've asked before, so I'm gonna go for this, just to try and keep it to different people. We'll come back to you if there's time.
I have a question actually concerning the controlled delivery of drugs. So what are the challenges of loading certain drugs into these polymers that you mentioned? So all the drugs, we can actually load them into a polymers, and then we have creams or lotions that can deliver these kind of drugs?
It's actually depending on the polymers that we're using, because the polymers that we use, first of all, these are biopolymers, and we have to choose them regarding their chemical or physical properties. And even the drugs that we're loading inside or even on the surface of the polymers, they have to adapt also to the polymer itself. For example, we can't mix, for example, positive to positive one, it won't work. We have to take, for example, a polymer, which is positively charged, and then we can take the drug which is negatively charged, and then we'll bind to each other via electrostatic interaction. So this is something that we have to take in consideration before we choose what kind of drug we use, to think first what kind of polymer we have to use as a carrier system.
Only at FameLab and certain cartels in Central America will you have a positives of the controlled delivery of drugs being discussed. Okay, I've got one more, so we'll go to you if there's no hands, but you've asked questions in the first two, so I was only joking, 3, 2, 1, fine. Go to you. Yep.
Question for Dina. You said, talking about hands and feet, that they were the easiest to deal with because of the extremities. How good are hands nowadays in terms of conveying touch back to the person using one?
In terms of what, please?
Well, you were touch. Talking about extremities.
Okay, yeah.
How
okay.
good are the hands nowadays, the bionic hands, at conveying touch back to the user?
Okay, so you mean, because in the talk I was talking about how my brain is going to give this motion, and the touch, you mean like I touch something cold or hot, like?
Pressure.
Pressure, yeah. It's all about sensors, okay? So the bionic leg or the hand gonna have sensors, okay, at the terminals of the nerves or at the terminals of the electrodes that I'm dealing with, that like nerves, so it will be like back and forth terminal. So it will start from these sensors that feel the hot or the feel the cold of either pressure, depending on the MRI and the forces that we are talking about before. So it will get it back to the brain, because it's all about biological wires. Did I answer your question or say the okay.
Partly. We'll accept it partly under the circumstances. And let me just check if the judges are back. I think the judges are just back in the room as well. I think, if that's the door opening. Perfect timing. Judges straight on stage. Can we please thank our 9 briefly united here as well? In the very nick of time, indeed. So let's start with you, Robert. Talk about the quarter hour of hell you've had trying to distill 3 from 9. You can sit down if you like, it's fine. Go on, let's be old-fashioned.
You'd all be listening to our deliberations if I left it on. Almost impossible task, and I think, as we've acknowledged a couple of times, a different set of judges might have come to a different decision as the audience might have. So I think very tough, and really just very impressed with all of the talks. Really fantastic engagement, fantastic enthusiasm for your science, and really just proud of all of you for what you've achieved.
Yeah, and it is worth stressing, it is an impossible task, but we're asking you to do it anyway. There's no way you can come up with a definitive ruling. These are the right 3. Okay, anybody else got comments before we go to actually to the reveal? Suze, you found the...
We were just saying that, you know, all of you, as it sounds awfully cliched, but you genuinely all are winners in your own countries. So you should be so proud of that, and don't stop here. There is so much more that you guys can be doing, and I'm sure will be doing, and will be putting all of us to shame, you know.
That is a lovely way. That's a lovely way. You're winners in your own countries. You just, most of you are losers in Greece. It's just a beautiful, beautiful poetic sentiment. I think it's worth having. Okay, I think we should have the reveal. Oh, nice, thank you.
Leandros.
Oh, no messing around, Leandros. Remember, this is no order, they're all equal as well, but obviously you can't read out 3 names at the same time, it's impossible.
Do one each.
Give it a try.
No.
Okay, well, you just blurt the last 2 together. That'd
be
really
okay.
No.
Alyssa.
Oh.
And Abby from Malaysia. Welcome.
Oh. Hey. Brilliant. Well done. And obviously tough so far. But maybe one more is going through. This is where we come on the golden envelope time. Thank you, Helen, making a ghostly appearance. Helen Kirkman, FameLab organizer. Thank you. Falls to me. Oh, ho, ho. It is not one of those three. One more of you is going through. The audience vote winner is Dean Al-Zahiri. Brilliant, that is it. Thank you again to our judges. Go on. We are now over the line and over the moon about our lineup for the final. Over the last 7 hours, nearly, we have seen 27 presentations that were not all just good, but absolutely famelabulous. Wait for just a little bit later, probably good, yeah. So, we've seen the winners of 27 countries in reverse alphabetical order. We have seen FameLabbers from Vietnam, USA, UK, Thailand, Switzerland, Spain, South Africa, Romania, Qatar, Portugal, Poland, Netherlands, Malaysia, Korea, Kazakhstan, Italy, Ireland, Hong Kong, Greece, Germany, Egypt, Czech Republic, Cyprus, Bulgaria, Brazil, Azerbaijan, and Australia. Okay, strictly speaking, 26 winners from 26 countries. Hong Kong is actually a special administrative region of the People's Republic of China, and Korea was represented by the runners-up. I don't want to be sued here as well. And our judges and our audience between them have chosen 8 from 27 already to go through to the final. That was Australia, Cyprus, Italy, Poland, Qatar, South Africa, Spain, and the UK. And they've just been joined by 4 more in alphabetical order: Egypt, Greece, USA, and can't read my writing there. That's not good. Malaysia. Look at that. There's no way that says Malaysia, is it? That's terrible writing. Sorry about that, Abdi. I just could not read my own writing there. Right, almost there, but as this is not just a marathon, but a triathlon and a trio of semi-finals draws to a close, we're going to close with a draw because the other thing they all need to know is what order they're all going in. So it's the draw for the running order of the final. On with the hat comes Tim from the British Council. Applause, please, for Tim Slingsby for the British Council. And the hat bearer. And he's going to give it to... Well, should we give it to each of them in turn, I think? This is going to be the order they appear in tomorrow night at the EDF Energy Arena, 8:30. I'm writing this down as we go. I think that's how it works, actually, yeah. Yeah. I mean, you could just know and they could guess, but I think it's probably easier.
Dina from Egypt.
Whoa, Egypt 1.
Alba from Spain.
Spain 2.
Erin from Australia.
Oz 3.
Leandros from Greece.
Greece 4.
Elissa from the USA.
USA 5.
Kyle from the UK.
Oh, USA then UK 6.
Nozipo from South Africa.
South Africa.
Lorenzo from Italy.
Italy.
Aida from Qatar.
Qatar 9.
I feel like we need to have a game where we read them all out in their accents. Because I could have done South Africa, but I can't do Malaysia. Malaysia, Abby.
Yeah.
Carolina from Poland.
Poland, Carolina.
Konstantinos.
Ah.
Well done.
From Cyprus.
From Cyprus. Okay, so that is our running order. That should be the right number. 12, we've got 12. That's a record in the final. We've normally had 9, but we've got 12 this time. So it's Egypt, Spain, Australia, Greece, USA, UK, South Africa, Italy, Qatar, Malaysia. That time I got it right. Poland and Cyprus. Can we please one more time congratulate our judges for their hard work? Robert, Ronnie and Suze. I want to thank all the backstage team, particularly Helen Kirkman at the Science Festival and Tim Slingsby from the British Council. Everybody backstage running this, and of course yourselves. And for those of you who've been here since 11 o'clock this morning like me, give yourselves a huge round of applause for stamina. So I am what's left of Quentin Cooper, tweeting us at QWERTY. I may be knackered, but I've had a fantastic day seeing some mind-blowing, world-spanning, head-spinning talent from 27 fantastic FameLabbers. Doesn't matter who got through to the final. It doesn't matter who does. They were all FameLabulous. A last round of applause for the entire FameLab pantheon.